That's what I expect. So I won't listen to them. What I listen to, I jump into community. Like I join Data Science Thailand meetup. I involve in those community and industry, do a lot of consultation. And I figure out what people in industry or community really want, and I become a part of them. I even wrote a curriculum first and let them read and feedback me. I don't even hear anybody in my school. It's a curriculum that is written by only me for a whole thing. Well, you may say, oh, this is crazy guy. You have to, you know, fight with everybody in a school. Luckily, it's not that bad. Only few professor in my school fight with me. Well, I may have some strong personality that people don't want to fight with me, but yeah, when program become more popular, you get more folks involved and take your side because they know that they will gain more benefits and they have more teaching loads, they have more income. And finally, they try to adjust themselves to teach a new courses. They try to reskill themselves. But you know, there are going to be someone who have a, I should say, bad attitude. Nobody can change yourself unless you want to change yourself. And if you don't want to change, then it's so hard that other people are going to intervene or change you. Nobody can change you unless you want to change yourself. So what I do, I just ignore them. I can choose who will teach in my curriculum. That's the way it is. But you have to be careful that you're really involved in industry and in communities so that you are at the state of the art and you hear a demand clearly. And you know what kind of competency that you have to build up your kids so that they will serve a labor demand. And once you are at that stage, then a kid will come to you directly. Don't have to do a lot. I rarely use a budget for PR. It just, the curriculum PR it by themselves. That's the way.
But is everyone easily adaptable?
No. Well, obviously no.
What's the biggest obstacle to change?
Attitude. Their attitude, not my attitude. Yeah, that's everything begins with attitude. And if you don't change your attitude, how can somebody can change you? It's impossible.
So, Ajahn, are you saying that to teach in your program, you may change the curriculum, you may change the course description
and all
very often?
Yeah, very often. And professor in my program, because it is my field too, that keep changing so fast. You know, something popular today will become obsolete next year really fast. And people in computer science kind of a poor people. What a pity, you have to change yourself. What you learn in grad school, in your PhD dissertation is zero right now, right? This is the way it is. So yeah, that's how, like, hey brother, when you gonna stop to change our curriculum? I'm so tiring. So I say, what else I can do? Because you know, everything become obsolete so fast. If you don't adjust, then our program won't survive. And if our program won't survive, all of us won't survive. The only way to survive is to adjust and rescue ourselves every year. That's the only way we can survive. So we have to work hard and learn hard. That's the only way. Yeah, there's gonna be someone oppose you. Or at first, they're gonna a little bit hesitant, but finally, when they see a story of success or number of enrollment, they will move in. But yeah, what should I say? You should cheer them up a little bit. That's what I have tried to. Or sometimes I think like, okay, this is a new course, and this is a book that you should read and prepare yourself for 1 year so that you can teach this course. I always do that. Once I write a course, I have to find a textbook and a research area that, okay, not even my area, but I know that it's direction there. It's a frontier of knowledge there. So I give them, okay, try to do this, learn this. So next year you teach this course. And my colleague at first feel like, oh man, this is really painful. But at the end of the day, they feel okay. But not all of them. Mm-hmm. Not all of them, I have to say.
I have a couple of questions and then I'll open the floor. Ajahn, what do you think about the value of a university degree in the future? Is it true that the next generation, they wouldn't value this piece of paper anymore? Would that be real or no?
It could be. If we still teach in a traditional university model like 400 years ago, and if we won't change, then a degree will be meaningless. As a master's school, as a graduate school, I admit a lot of newly undergrad students each year. Don't say that, I say, okay. I'm really questions like, hey, what kind of degree you got? And what's in your brain? You know, like, when they got in, I'm like, really? You got like second class honor in mathematics? Seriously? This is second class honor, seriously? You know, a grade in undergrad sometimes become inflated and become meaningless in some certain extent. And also what university teach right now is not that matched to a real world of work. We teach something tends to be extremely abstract. Don't say that I don't believe in the value of liberal education. I graduate from a school that has a Catholic liberal education. They even learn something like aesthetics, faith and reasoning for their undergrad. But there's going to be something that has to be adjusted to a new world so that it will be easier to be adopted, to be in a real use or real practice. It is the way it is.
Thank you, Ajahn. I think Ajahn Brian probably has a question, so I'll skip to him first.
Yes, please.
The quality of applicants is going way down.
Oh, yes.
More technical
sorts. That is so true. And you know what? A real motivation for me to improve my curriculum and to make it become famous because I want a high quality student, student with high quality. I want to teach a kid that is smart. And the only way to change it is to build your future by yourself. So at that time, when I first start, a quality of student at NIDA in my program is just okay. Because like, you know, for a weekend program, we have 25 applicants and we enroll 15. But when you have 300 applicants and you choose only 40, it becomes extremely competitive. And now you have extremely keen and work really hard and you also like already motivated to study and to work, but they really demand you too. I have confronted with a real practical questions in my class that I can't answer. Almost every class, they keep asking a very challenging question that, or even sometimes like, oh, this is really tough question. I even don't know it before, and I never heard that somebody did it before. It should be your dissertation topics, and you have to find an answer by your own. That's what I said to them, you know. And sometimes I say, okay, let me think about it and let me explore it. Perhaps next week I can answer your questions. I won't try that I'm smart to answer every question because it's impossible. And those smart kids will know that I don't really know. It's a fake knowledge. So you have to be really faithful to them when you have a very high quality students. That's the way. Yeah, but it won't be easy to change a situation like I have done. So a process of like you have, I think one nice thing about undergrad school, undergrad, you have about 4 years, which is long enough for you to scaffolding them, to coach them. It's long enough. If you really care of them, I think you have enough time to change them so that they can get better. This is one nice thing about undergrad. But I know there's another something not nice, like they always skip class, or they want to do kind of dancing rather than studying, you know, or you know, a lot of like love relationship, whatever. But yeah, undergrad can be a tedious work, but sometimes really pay off because you have enough time to build up them as you expect, but you have to devote.